Hi everyone, today we will continue with this sulfuric acid prochemical properties and the properties exhibited by concentrated sulfuric acid. In the previous video it was about dilute, now it is about concentrated, and there are certain things that we need to know about this. One is it is a strong oxidizing agent. So it has its oxidizing properties. The second one is it is the least or non-volatile acid compared to the volatile acids like hydrochloric acid, nitric acid. It is a non-volatile acid because it has a very high boiling point of 338 degrees Celsius. Then the third one, it is a dehydrating agent which removes molecules of water from the structure of compounds. That's called as a dehydrating agent. So now let's move on to the oxidizing property. So sulfuric acid as an oxidizing agent. When can a compound act as an oxidizing agent? When it is able to oxidize the other compounds that it comes across. Now when you take sulfuric acid, it can break down into water plus sulfur dioxide, plus it also releases nascent oxygen. Nascent oxygen means the most active form of any element is in the nascent form. It's inborn, and this will oxidize in turn any element that it comes across, and sulfuric acid will be reduced to sulfur dioxide. We have two elements that we need to know about: carbon and sulfur being oxidized by concentrated sulfuric acid. So when carbon reacts with concentrated sulfuric acid, carbon will react with oxygen to give carbon dioxide. Hydrogen will be oxidized to water. Sulfuric acid is reduced to sulfur dioxide. Okay. So, 2 here, which means there will be 2. 8. 2. So this is the reaction that happens when carbon is oxidized by sulfuric acid. Next, if sulfur is oxidized by sulfuric acid, we don't have carbon. All we have is just sulfur. So sulfur becomes sulfur dioxide. In other words, sulfuric acid gets reduced to sulfur dioxide. Hydrogen gets oxidized to water. 2 here, 3 and 2. These are the oxidizing reactions of sulfuric acid. Next we have sulfuric acid as the least or non-volatile acid. A non-volatile acid can displace a volatile acid from its salt. This must be in our mind every time we work on this property, because this also comes, or we use it for the preparation of hydrogen chloride as well as nitric acid. Okay, so if we take the preparation of hydrogen chloride, we can use two things, either sodium chloride or potassium chloride with concentrated sulfuric acid. So this will displace hydrogen chloride, and the salt that we get, if the temperature is below 200, then we get sodium bisulfate plus HCl. Here it would be potassium bisulfate plus HCl. Okay, so this has displaced this acid from its salt. Okay, so this happens for hydrogen chloride and it happens for nitric acid also using either sodium nitrate or potassium nitrate, and the same concentrated sulfuric acid can displace them less than 200 to give sodium bisulfate, same product, only the acid formed is different. Okay, again this has been displaced from its salt. Nitric acid displaced from sodium nitrate. These are the properties of non-volatile acid. Now what is the difference between drying and dehydrating? Sulfuric acid can act as a drying agent as well as a dehydrating agent. But the fact that it is a drying agent is something on the superficial. See, when you feel dry, when you are thirsty, you feel you are dry, your mouth is dry and you just drink a little bit of water and then you are fine. But if you have severe vomiting and a lot of water is lost from the body, then you say you feel dehydrated. Means water is removed from the structure. That is dehydrating. That strength that this sulfuric acid has, because it is a hygroscopic liquid. You should not forget this word, hygroscopic. Okay. This we learn with some examples. One is its action on sugars. The first one being glucose, which is C6H12O6. Okay, when you add concentrated sulfuric acid to sugar, it will remove these molecules of water. How many molecules are there? You see there is H12O6 and water structure is H2O. So how many are there? There are 6. Okay, so 6 molecules of water. All that is there is removed. And what is left out is 6 carbon atoms. So this is how it removes the molecules of water from the structure. Okay, now let's move on to the disaccharide or cane sugar, which is C12H22O11. In case you don't remember this, how to find it out? See, when you take C6H12O6, this is sugar, add one more, it becomes C12H24O12. Every time a sugar molecule is added to another sugar molecule, it always adds up with removal of one molecule of water. That's called condensation polymer. So when you remove one molecule of water from this, what do you get? H22O11. That is this sugar. So you can remember it easily that way. Alright, now going into this cane sugar. When this also is concentrated sulfuric acid is added to cane sugar, sometimes sugar cane, this can be sugar crystals also. Then how many are there? You get 11 molecules of water and what is left out is 12 atoms of carbon. The next one is a polysaccharide. Okay, many units are combined together. How do you combine many units together? See, supposing you have C6H12O6, n number of units, then for every addition, there must be removal of one molecule of water, which means you would have C6H10O5. Okay, fine. Now you go to C6H10O5, n number. This is a polysaccharide. Many units together. This could be starch, this could be amylose or whatever, cellulose. So it could be wood, it could be paper. Anything that is made of many units is called a polysaccharide. This would give you this, and n times, and H2O5, and that again n times. So these are the dehydrating reactions of sugar. Now there is an important observation that we need to remember. As far as these sugars go, all of them work in the same way. So sugar, basically sugars, crystals or glucose, if you take, they are white in color, they are crystalline. Okay, so you have crystals of sugar here, and these white sugar will get turned into a black charred spongy mass of carbon. Sugar turns into, all these are important. So you have a black color, it is charred, it is also spongy. Usually it will be completely less, but here it is spongy. So when I take some sugar and I add some concentrated sulfuric acid to it, okay, the moment I add concentrated sulfuric acid to it, it turns into something like this. So it is a black spongy charred mass of carbon. So it's not settling down, but it's just raising up as a spongy mass, and it's black in color and it is charred. Copper sulfate is a pentahydrate. What do you mean by that? It has 5 molecules of water of crystallization. Water of crystallization is also responsible for the crystalline nature. Now this copper sulfate, if you have noticed, it is blue in color. Copper sulfate is blue in color, and it is also crystalline. Now to this, when you add concentrated sulfuric acid, it removes the molecules of water of crystallization, and it converts this copper sulfate pentahydrate into anhydrous, which means there is no water, and this becomes white. So one is anhydrous, second one is white. It also becomes amorphous. Here it is crystalline, here it is amorphous. And as a recap, when it acts on sugars, it reduces all the forms of sugar, whether it's a monosaccharide, a disaccharide or a polysaccharide, into the same carbon, which results in a black, charred, spongy mass of carbon. And when it reacts with copper sulfate hydrated or pentahydrate, it converts the blue crystalline copper sulfate into anhydrous white amorphous. Amorphous means a powdery one with droplets of water on the sides. So these are the dehydrating properties of sulfuric acid.